World Press Freedom Day on Monday, President Rodrigo Duterte declared that his administration would continue to protect the media. This is killings and red baiting of members of the industry remain rampant. It also came 2 days before the first anniversary of the Philippines' largest network going off air after the expiration of its broadcast franchise. How has the media landscape changed a year since the ABS-CBN shut down? Joining us this morning to share their thoughts, it's veteran journalist and Pulitzer winner Manny Mugato, our correspondent Mike Navallo, who is the head of the ABS-CBN chapter of the National Union of Journalists of the Philippines. Good morning, gentlemen, and thank you for joining us today.
Good morning.
Good morning, Christian. Good morning, Sir Manny.
Yeah, good morning.
Of course, we're marking an anniversary today, but this is not a cause for celebration, definitely. I'd like to frame this conversation with how this decision by the NTC, obviously upon the instigation of President Rodrigo Duterte, has affected the way we do journalism, not just at ABS-CBN, but in the Philippines in general. I'd like to start with Manny. How do you think this has affected journalists and the cause of press freedom since the shutdown?
It's a sad day for Philippine journalism when President Duterte ordered the shutdown of the country's largest broadcaster, ABS-CBN. And for a year now, it has impacted, no? Actually, we journalists are doing our jobs even without this station. But the impact is more on the people who are deprived of information, especially news, coming from legitimate and reputable organization. Because what we do have now is that people are relying more on social media to get their news and information. But sad to say that in social media, especially in Facebook and Twitter, there are a lot of disinformation and propaganda. We only get accurate and reliable information from legitimate, traditional, and legacy media like ABS-CBN. And without ABS-CBN, it has changed the way of life. Okay. But we journalists continue to do our work.
Okay. In the case of you, Mike, as a reporter of the network, how has this affected the way you do journalism? Has this somehow emboldened you further or perhaps affected or made you more sensitive to, for example, criticism coming from supporters of President Duterte?
Well, to be honest, Christian, I don't think that has changed in the sense that we continue to rely on, you know, what we do. We continue to check the facts. We continue to be a watchdog to government. And I guess it to a certain extent, because, you know, there's nothing to lose. We don't have a franchise anyway. There's a certain part of you that tells you that we should be going after these stories to be able to inform the people. So I'd like to think that it has not somehow affected the way I personally do my journalism. But I cannot take away the fact that taking out the largest media organization in the Philippines already creates a chilling effect to the rest of the media in the Philippines. I mean, imagine the biggest network, the president can shut it down, or his supporters in Congress. Well, that says a lot, because what will now be the position of those who are not as well-known, were not as big as ABS-CBN, can they now do the same kind of journalism that they have been doing in the past 2 years?
And of course, also early on during at the height of the controversy regarding the franchise application of ABS-CBN, the narrative being propagated by the administration, by supporters of the president, was that he had nothing to do with the efforts to shut down ABS-CBN. But he himself admitted that, acknowledged that a few days after the House of Representatives, led by supporters of the president, rejected the franchise application of ABS-CBN for whatever reason. Right? But do you think somehow that narrative became successful, or somehow that has been corrected over the past year? And more importantly, how do you think the public has reacted to that? Did the things become clearer for the public that President Duterte indeed had something to do with this and we should not lie about it? What do you think, Manny?
I think the president's people, especially Harry Roque, did not succeed in convincing the public that President Duterte has nothing to do with the shutdown. Because everyone in the government from the NTC and the Congress, which is controlled by the president because of his tremendous support from his allies in Congress, would show that everything was done because of Duterte's wishes. And the number of followers of people in ABS-CBN social media, especially in Facebook and Twitter and in YouTube, would show that the people did not believe Harry Roque or his people who were trying to say that the president is not behind the shutdown. I think there will be a time of reckoning for this action, maybe in 1 year.
Meaning?
During election.
Mike, looking back at the events prior to the shutdown of ABS-CBN, and even after the application for a new franchise was rejected by the House Franchise Committee, do you think journalists should have responded more actively, more passionately, more concretely to that very concrete threat against press freedom, not just ABS-CBN's franchise application at that time?
I think so. And it should have begun when the president attacked, for example, the Inquirer, or the president attacked Rappler. I think we can all admit that media solidarity here in the Philippines is something that we can still work on. Because when the people did not speak up against the attacks on the Inquirer, on Rappler, I believe that emboldened the administration. So now it has come to a point where it was able to actually shut down the ABS-CBN broadcast operation. So it's a domino effect. And if we don't stop the administration from the very beginning, it might be too late. And that's what really happened with ABS-CBN. If we don't develop this culture of pushing back, it will only embolden whoever is in power.
But do you think we have learned our lesson afterward? The industry, ABS-CBN itself, and the rest of the industry, that after the ABS-CBN was shut down, this has finally opened the eyes of a lot of journalists.
Well, it's a work in progress, Christian, because I do see a lot of good journalism. We do see a lot of fact-checking nowadays. But there are still some reports that are lacking in context or lacking in terms of digging deeper or pushing back or asking the right questions. And I guess we cannot blame also some of our colleagues, because in the current setup, in the pandemic, most of the press conferences, for example, are held online and they are moderated. And so the opportunity to push back may not be the same as when we were before, or as before during before the pandemic. So there's that limitation. There's the government imposed limitation because of the pandemic, but also some of the institutions in government have not been very forthright in sharing information with the journalists. You have, for example, the Office of the Ombudsman not releasing certain documents to the media. So there's that. There's an institutional limitation imposed by government, and also the limitations imposed by the pandemic.
Okay. In your case, Manny, do you still sense that fear across newsrooms after ABS-CBN was shut down?
Of course.
As you speak. Or yeah. Do you think journalists in general have become bolder because of this?
I agree with Mike that there's a chilling effect on the shutdown of ABS-CBN. I still believe that Filipino journalists, especially the networks, the management, the owners of the media in the Philippines are still, they still fear the power of the government. If they can do it on ABS-CBN, they can also do it on their own networks or on their own publication or in their own net outlets. So there is still a fear, but for the working journalists, the ones who are pounding the beat, I don't see any pressure. Although they are being careful, it makes them more cautious of what they're doing, but they are fighting back, they're pushing back against this administration.
But do you think we did enough at that time? in terms of pushback? Because, of course, no. We knew, we felt, and we knew perhaps that whatever happened, President Duterte was intent on shutting down ABS-CBN. He had his personal flimsy reasons, definitely. But in terms of pushback from our side?
We did not. I think it's there's a lot of room for improvement and for journalists to band together, to be united, to stand against this government.
Mike, what do you think stopped many journalists from doing more or acting more boldly in the face of this threat coming from the administration at that time?
Well, I would think that perhaps because we're dealing with an especially different kind of administration right now. While we do have some previous presidents who are hostile to the media, I don't think it has come to a point where the president can actually move towards, you know, shutting down a network or perhaps going after, openly going after those who criticize him and his supporters or his staff or his personal assistant. So there's that. It's a new environment. And also perhaps because I would like to think that some of us in the Philippines, I'd like to say that culture is also a relevant factor here. We're not used to being confrontational. When we ask questions, we tend to be polite. And so it somehow, I think, limits the kind of questions that we ask of our interviewees. And so there's that element at play, I'd like to think.
Yung journalists are generally deferential to their sources, no? They are very conscious not to offend people. I think that's also cultural, as you mentioned. But Manny, when it comes to solidarity coming from media, do you sense that somehow this has finally helped unite members of the media?
I don't think so, Christian. There is no solidarity, there is no unity among journalists in the Philippines because there are some groups who are supporting the government. There are some groups who are former journalists who are now in government. So it's very hard to have unity and solidarity and cohesion in the face of threats from the president or from this administration. And another problem is that the journalists, I think, does not have support from their own management, because the owners of this media are thinking about their own survival. They would not dare challenge the government because they fear that if they can close down ABS-CBN, it can also happen to them. So it takes a lot of factors to unite the media and the press in the Philippines.
Okay, that's a very interesting point that you mentioned. But how do you guys think this could be somehow addressed if not resolved? Understandably, if you talk about the media ownership structure here in the Philippines, there's a lot to be, we need to improve a lot on that. Understandably, those in power would try to pressure the business owners, not just ABS, not just the workers, not just the employees. And of course, you have a different way of looking at things. If you're running a business, primarily, you're running a business. If you're doing journalism, you are a journalist. But personally, I believe if you enter into this business of journalism, it's an entirely different animal. It cannot be treated as just another business. But talking about that pressure exerted on business owners, how do you guys think that can be fixed or that can be addressed so as to limit how this could affect the newsroom operations? Mike, what do you think?
Well, Christian, that's tough, though. I cannot speak on behalf of the management, but certainly a big deal or a big portion of that will have to involve the owners and a collective realization that we are in the business of a public trust. And so therefore, and our public service should go beyond what our personal interests or business gains should dictate. But I guess it's hard to say that because there are various factors to it. And so it takes a collective effort. And also, one thing I should also point out is that competition among media organizations here in the Philippines is also a factor. So it's not just a matter of the government pressuring the owners, but competition among the media owners, that's also a factor why some decisions might have been made.
Okay, Manny, what do you think?
I think it's very difficult for media owners to push back because they're in a business and they also have a lot of interests that will be affected. For instance, some of the owners are into other regulated business. Telecommunication, utilities, mining. So it's very hard for them to go against an administration which is threatening the media. So I think for the media to be free and independent, it should be free from other businesses. If you look at models abroad, I would say Reuters, for instance, the business is separate from what they do in journalism. So they can be neutral, they can be free from any biases, and they can attack or hit governments freely without any fear of reprisal. But lately, because this organization is also selling information in the public, they were being suppressed in China because most of their business, their economic and business news are being held by the Chinese government. So there is still some pressure. So I think for the press to be free, they should be free from any business that could be regulated or by the government.
Of course, that is more of an ideal.
It's a utopia.
Utopia, definitely. Because if you look at the media structure in the Philippines, it's very, very difficult to do something like that. So that's why it's also important for someone, a businessman, if he's entering that particular business, journalism, there has to be a clear understanding of what journalism is all about. That it's part business, definitely, because you need profit. You need to provide the resources to the newsroom. But more importantly, you need to respect the important role of journalism in society. Now, Mike, I'd like to go to you. For instance, you're also a lawyer, by the way, guys. Mike Navalle is also a lawyer. Looking at the process of securing franchise or broadcast franchise here in the Philippines, going by the events last year and going by the lessons that we learned, perhaps, or I hope, regarding that incident, how do you think this should be fixed?
Actually, Christian, there's really a lot of talk about, at least from those who advocate for press freedom, to free broadcast companies from any form of regulation by the government. And I guess we should look into why broadcast licenses are being implemented in the first place. And that's because there's a limited space, limited resource that can be distributed to different users. But moving into the digital age, perhaps we can consider moving beyond that, because what certainly happened was that the whole process was politicized. While you have here an organization that has long sought renewal of a franchise, well, lawmakers sat on it until it lapsed, and until finally they decided we're not renewing it. And I guess that process could have been avoided. You free up that whole politicization of the renewal process if you do not entrust this in the hands of lawmakers or other politicians who might have vested interest in whether or not to renew your broadcast license. And for me, I think that constitutes a restriction when you cannot broadcast because you have to depend on a franchise from a government agency, and the means by which you can secure that franchise renewal may not always be clear. If it's subject to discretion of those who are giving it, rather than a body that will just process your papers and grant you that franchise if you meet the requirements. So that's something to think about. But considering that it's also lawmakers who are going to implement changes, if at all, they are going to pass a law amending the current structure, I see no changes anytime soon. Perhaps we can address that by moving to the digital age, by moving to digital, where you're free from any requirement of licenses because of restrictions on bandwidth.
Manny, what do you think? Is it even realistic to hope for this process to be somehow depoliticized or even take that away from Congress?
I think we have a precedent with President Duterte ordering the shutdown of ABS-CBN. So I think we cannot remove that already. It's very difficult when media franchises are regulated by government. And I think the government is too powerful, even if we don't have franchises, even if we broadcast through the internet, the government can still shut down the internet. We look at Myanmar, yeah. We look at China, we look at many countries around the world that can control the internet. So it's very difficult for us in the media to operate without government control.
Okay, now moving forward, I know that a lot of our colleagues and a lot of the supporters of ABS-CBN are thinking that perhaps after 2022, there would be bigger hope for ABS-CBN to renew or to regain its broadcast franchise, assuming that the next president would not be aligned very closely with President Rodrigo Duterte. But realistically, do you think, guys, that would be as easy as that? Or that, I'm speaking for myself, or that is quite simplistic as a matter of, as a way of looking at things? Because do you think that with the way President Duterte was able to control media in general here in the Philippines and order the shutdown of ABS-CBN, the largest broadcast company in the Philippines, that the next president, whoever that person is, could also realize and somehow be emboldened that I could also exert a bit of control or move or push the envelope further in terms of making sure that this media organizations would follow my wishes, perhaps not as boldly or as crassly as President Duterte has been doing it. Mike.
Well, that has certainly opened the floodgates, Christian, so to speak. I mean, if they've seen how President Duterte has done it, certainly that creates a reasonable expectation in their minds that they can also do it. So it really depends on who the next president will be. So it's really important to choose in May 2022 who the next president will be, whether or not that person will adopt the same kind of approach for the media.
Finally, I'd like to get your thoughts, guys, on this. On the occasion of the World Press Freedom Day last Monday, quite interestingly, the president was expected to issue a statement, but I'd like to go to this part of his statement where he said, the press must be protected from all forms of threat and intimidation so they can fully serve the best interests of our people. What do you make of this, Manny, given President Duterte's track record on or perhaps against the news media in the Philippines?
It's lip service. Because it's not happening, it's not protecting the press in the Philippines. He's actually threatening it. He wanted to control it, and he wanted only his views and the favorable reporting about his administration. So it's just basically lip service.
How about you, Mike? And finally, you may also want to talk about the establishment of an ABS-CBN chapter of the National Union of Journalists of the Philippines as a way of ending this conversation, this sad and perhaps frustrating conversation about what happened to ABS-CBN a year ago and what has been happening to journalism in general in the Philippines under President Duterte.
Well, I hope we can all practice what we preach. I mean, that applies to the president, that applies to us as media practitioners, and I think that's really the goal. We recently revived the ABS-CBN chapter of NUJP, partly not just to uphold press freedom, but to also look after the welfare of our fellow journalists here in ABS-CBN. but also to uphold our own sense of accountability. We could only rely on self-regulation to be able to regain the trust of the public and show the government that, you know, we cannot just allow being pushed aside, or we cannot just allow these kinds of undermining of media freedom in the country.
Okay, Mike Navallo and Manny Mogato, thank you, gentlemen. Thank you guys for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
Stay safe. Our pleasure, Christian.
You.